Surgery day is a long day. It's actually longer for the parents than it is for the patients. Everybody always wants to ask the day before surgery, you know, what's going to happen and when is it going to happen? And usually you don't know until late the afternoon before surgery when the order of cases is scheduled. In the operating room, they usually do the youngest patients first. So usually our patients with adolescent idiopathic scoliosis are the longest cases and the oldest patients. So they'll often be kind of the last case to start in the day. Everybody is required generally to be on the third floor, the inpatient unit, at least 3 hours before their surgery is scheduled to start. About 2 hours before the surgeon actually starts the surgery, the nurse on the floor will give the patient something to help them relax, either a pill or liquid, depending on the patient's preference. And then over the course of the next 30 minutes, the patient and their family will move downstairs into what's called the holding area. And there's a nurse there that will sign them in and ask a lot of questions. Oftentimes a member of the surgery team will come by, and if they haven't already, they'll sign the patient's back where the incision is going to be made. And the anesthesiologist will come and obtain a consent from the patient or from the parents. And then eventually, all the paperwork and computer work will be done, and they'll be ready to what we call roll back to the operating room. From the time the family kisses their child goodbye to the time where the surgery actually starts is usually 45 minutes, anywhere from 30 minutes to an hour. So you're kind of prepared for surgery and push off, but it's really 2 hours before the surgery starts. I think preparing yourself for posterior spine fusion for idiopathic scoliosis is both probably a physical and emotional part. And they're both really, really important. The physical part is to make sure that you stop any aspirin or anti-inflammatories probably 6 weeks before your surgery. It's really important that your surgeon and the entire care team know if you use oral contraceptive pills, because they can increase the risk of you having a blood clot after surgery. And so it's really important that we have that information as far ahead of time and as accurately as possible. It's important to have a well-balanced diet and have plenty of protein. And regular aerobic exercise is really, really important to keep yourself fit. As your surgery gets nearer, the week or two before your surgery, you want to avoid getting an upper respiratory illness that would require your surgery to be canceled and rescheduled, because you've made that emotional investment. As far as preparing for yourself emotionally, I think fear comes from uncertainty, and uncertainty comes from the unknown. So the more that you can learn about it, the more you can make yourself available to the resources that are available to talk to other patients who have been through it. And realize one of the things that I tell the families of the patients that I have that have idiopathic scoliosis surgery is it's, for 90%+ of the families, it's unquestionably the biggest and most stressful event of their nuclear family's lives. But the amazing thing, and what's so fun for us, is they recover so quickly. And things go so predictably, and they make such a good, steady recovery that it's really fun to watch the family move through this very kind of stressful time and come out on the other side. After the surgeon has shown the family the x-rays, the family will go back upstairs, and they'll wait for about another 30 minutes as the patient gets situated in the post-anesthetic care unit, or the PACU. And then the family will be called down, and two members of the family can go into the PACU to be with the patient. The family will be with the patient for about 30 minutes in the PACU, and then they'll go upstairs to room 306. Usually the family sits in the waiting room for another 30 minutes or an hour while the nurses get report and get the patient situated and get all the IVs and all the lines set at the appropriate settings. And then the family will come back in the room, and they'll be with the patient in the room until they go home in a few days. Once you're ready to go home, everybody is allowed to walk and climb stairs and ride in the car. We have patients that ride 6 or 8 hours in a car, or travel on an airplane 3 or 4 days after the surgery. It's not uncommon at all. With regards to activities and when do you shower and when do you resume bending and lifting, there's a lot of variation depending on the surgeon and on the patient and the type of operation they had. And your surgeon will tell you exactly what her or his preference is. constipation is probably the number one reason why families have to call after surgery. So the keys to addressing constipation are to stay really well hydrated. We usually recommend at least 6 kind of normal sized bottles of water a day. Most patients will go home with a stool softener. Really the only other thing in the early postoperative period for families to worry about is if there's significant drainage from the wound. It's normal for a wound to make spots, but if it's seeping enough fluid that the dressing is soaked and cannot dry itself out, then that's something you should immediately notify us about. At around 2 weeks, they start to kind of be able to care for themselves, and the mothers understand at 2 weeks, they're kind of self-sufficient, but they don't have their normal kind of adolescent mojo and surliness back until probably 4 to 6 weeks after the surgery. But most of them are back to completely normal daily activities by 6 weeks.